Welcome everybody to the second tutorial of XPaths. In our previous session, we have learned to create your basic as well as your advanced XPath in Selenium. The link of that I will be giving in the description below. In this tutorial, we will be focusing on five very important functions when creating your advanced XPaths. Those are given on your screen. Let us now try to understand your contains function with the help of an example. So open up your Chrome browser to the sample application. The link I will be giving in the description. You scroll all the way down to this particular element right here. The moment you click on random, you see the particular message is changing. Now in all of your messages, this part of the text, which is has logged in successfully, is always constant, whereas your starting and your ending is always changing. Now I cannot uniquely identify this element based on text alone because the text is not constant. So what I can do is I can use your contains function and uniquely identify this based on a partial match. So the steps to do this is going to be the following. Create a normal XPath. So Control F, double forward slash. This here is having a paragraph tag right here. So P followed by your square brackets. Now what you would usually do is you would type text, your parentheses, and then you give your text. But this is only going to do an exact match. What you want to do is a partial match. So for that you use your new function called as contains. So contins, and then you give your parentheses. Your contains guys is going to have two parameters. So put a comma, your first parameter here and your second parameter here. Your first parameter is going to decide where do you want your match to take place. Whether it is an attribute, for example @ID is an attribute, or it is in text. So in our case, for now, we are going to uniquely identify based on partial match of a text, right? So we are going to give your text and then your parentheses. Your second parameter is going to be what do you want to search inside of the text. So I want this particular part of the text to be verified, which is has logged in successfully. So give that as your second parameter, and as you can see, it searches the text based on a partial match. Now in a similar condition, you can not only just search your text, but it can be a parameter as well. So if I scroll above and I come to this example right here, which is unique ID. As I can see, the ID here is ID1. So instead of text, I can just type here @ID, because I want to this time not search for the text, but search for the ID. And instead of giving the entire ID, which is ID1, it will work even if I give a partial ID such as D1, and that matches as well. So again guys, you can basically verify the partial match of anything, attributes or text, inside of your application with the help of your contains function. The other thing is your contains function is not standalone. You can combine contains with attributes as well. For example, if I wanted to combine contains with a text match, then I would just do contains, your ID is having D1, and a text having this text right here. I can even combine attributes as well. It is all okay. There are basically no issues by using contains. Now a similar function to contains is also called as starts with. So let us come back to our previous example. Now if I were to just change the time, you would see that the starting part of the text, which is logged in successfully, is always constant. Only the ending is changing. So for this example, you can again do the exact same thing as before, which is, let me remove off this particular piece of code here. So contains a text having the value logged in successfully, and it works. But this would not be a right approach, because in XPaths you try to be as precise as possible. So because your starting is always the same, only your ending is changing, what you can do is instead of contains, you can use a function called as starts with. So starts, starts, a hyphen, and with, and that will work just fine. So you have to use starts with when your starting part of your text or any attribute is constant, and use contains when only a partial match is possible. So in this way, we have looked at contains as well as starts with. Let us look at the other three functions right now. Let us now look at your other three functions with the help of a different example. So you open up Chrome and you navigate to this different example here. The link again I will be giving in the description below. Now this web page over here has got a web table. Now if you spy on the web table, you would see that it has got a tag called hasTable with the ID is equal to table 1. So let me write an XPath to identify this web table. So --/ table with the attribute ID is equal to table 1, and that identifies the table uniquely. Now if you look at it closely, inside of the table you have got a body and then you have got a tr. Now the moment I hover over tr, it basically is highlighting my very first row. So tr over here basically means rows. So tr, 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 it basically means that I've got 6 rows in my web table. So if I were to just do --/ tr, as you can see on my right hand side corner, 1 of 6. So this is my first row, my second, third, fourth, and so on so forth. Now if I wanted to uniquely identify my first row, I can just give a square brackets like this and specify the number 1. So this is my first row, my second, third. Now guys, here I'm saying rows because I'm working on the web table. But in reality, it is what? It is that I've got 6 instances of my tr element, and I am verifying, or I'm getting my first instance, my second, my third, my fourth, my fifth, and then my sixth. Now you can give your indexes either by giving in the square brackets, or you can use your position function to do the same. So POSITR position followed by your parentheses, and then you give your position value. So this is my position 1 or my row 1, and so on so forth. Now let us look at a real life example here as well. What if you had a condition where you had to get the values of your very last row? Now here I can easily do that because I know the total number of rows is 6, so I give the value 6. But what if the number of rows was not fixed? It was not static. Today it's 6, tomorrow it's 7, and so on so forth. Then that can cause a problem, right? In this case, you can just use a function called as last. So type last followed by your parentheses, and it will always point to your very last index. As you can see here, it is pointing to my last index right here. Now I can take this a bit step further. Your last index over here, your last row points to this particular row tr. Inside tr I've got a td, and inside td I have a checkbox. So if I just do --td/input, you can see it verifies, or it is pointing to the checkbox. So this can be my use case. You know, I want to check or to delete my very last row, and this is going to be the XPath. In order to delete my second last row, I can just use --1, and this will point to my second last, third last, and so on so forth. The same thing can be done by indexes as well. I can give 1, I can give 1+1, 1+2, and so on so forth. I can give mathematical expressions inside of these parentheses as well. Okay, now with that said, let us look at a different example now, which is count. Now count is something which is not used usually in XPath, but if you know how to use it, it will save you a lot of coding in your actual Selenium or whichever function tool that you're using. So what is count? Count is going to give you the total number of instances of an element found. So let me come back to my application. So here I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rows. So if I just do count and I give the XPath of rows, it will return for me the value 6. So it can be used in a particular manner. What if I had this box here, and this box has got 2 buttons? So I want to get a particular box that has got only 2 buttons. I can use a function count. In the same example of a web table, let us verify a web table that has got only 6 rows. Okay. So let me remove off all of these values here. So we are going to identify a table, but not by the ID, but by using the function called as count. So table, and then you give the function count. And inside of this, you have to specify the XPath of the element which you want to count. So you will start with a dot because you want to search inside of your web table. Notice that moment I put a dot, table here is getting highlighted. So always start with a dot. If you do not give a dot, it will search anywhere in your web page again. So always use a dot. So I want to search what inside my web table? I want to search for all TR instances. Okay. Now this is basically going to return for me a particular value, which is basically 6. So I'll say that I want to find a web table having total number of TR elements, which is equal to 6. And as you can see, I'm uniquely identified the particular web table right here having only 6 rows. In our next session, we'll be looking at more 7 functions which are also important in XPath. We'll also look at how to identify a particular element by ignoring its case as well as spaces. I will be giving the link of this tutorial in the description below. If you have any questions in this tutorial, do comment below. I will help you out. If you like this entire series on XPaths, do show your support by liking and sharing this video and subscribe to my channel. Thank you all for watching.